I'm an author, speaker, life and business coach, and a direct sales expert. On the Kingpinion Show, I'll introduce you to today's hottest entrepreneurs, celebrity guests, individuals who would inspire and motivate you with their stories. And as a wife and a mom, I'll show you how to balance career and family. My name is Kingpinion, and I'm here to equip, encourage, and empower lives.
I'm going to talk to you tonight about seven qualities of a world-class woman. And it's, of course, from a man's point of view. God had to appoint man in leadership because he could have never earned it. Like I said, a lot of things, but the little book here is very powerful because your goals choose your mentors. Your goals choose what you're willing to ignore. I'm going to ask you to turn on the inside of this book, and in the very last page inside the book, I'm going to ask you to write down the top 10 dreams and goals of your life. The top 10, at the top, put my top 10 dreams of my life, just inside the blank cover, just inside the cover. I'd like for you to write down, if God handed you a pen and said the next 2 days, or the next 2 minutes, anything you write down will take place in your lifetime. Anything you write down will take place. You say, Brother Mike, I don't have a pen. See, I'd make that my first goal, wouldn't you? I'd make that my very first one. And if you've got a friend next to you. 2 minutes, anything you want to become, anything you want to do, anything you want to have. Need a pen from somebody? Remember for once that pen coming. Okay. Anything you want to become, anything you want to do, anything you want to have. You may write down, I want to reach platinum. You may want to write down, I want to travel. I want to lose 30 pounds. I want to have a debt-free house. I want to learn a foreign language. I want to go back to college and get a degree. I don't care what it is, write it down. The top 10 things that you'd like to become. Everything in your world starts with your goals. What do you want to experience? Anything you want to become. Anything you want to do. Anything you want to own. Your goals are your desired experiences. What you want to create or experience during your lifetime. The top 10. Your goals decide what you should ignore in your life. Your goals will purge your relationships. Will expose your Absaloms and your Judases. Your goals are opportunities for friends to confirm their loyalty to you. Your goals decide your energy. Choose the knowledge you should pursue. The mentors you should receive from. Anything you want to become, anything you want to do. These are your goals. No one else's. Your goals. Your goals work with your faith. The clearer your goal, the greater your faith. Your goals are your chosen focus. Your goals reveal what matters most to you. If you run out after 4 or 5, that's okay. You can add to it later. If you've written down 20, you've already disobeyed the instructions. 10 goals, your top 10 goals. Now look over your goals and let's add some details. How many wrote you want to travel? How many want to travel? Okay. Now add to that, travel where? You already traveled here tonight, so that's 1 4 4 goals. So let's, where do you want to travel? You want to go to Rome?
The world.
You want to go to Cairo to see pyramids? You want to go to New York to swim? Wherever you want, write down your goals. Anything you want to become, do or have during your lifetime. I mean, write down if you wrote down, I want to lose weight, how many pounds? I'm 60. That's what I want to lose, 60 pounds. That's one of my goals. If you wrote down, I want to buy a car. What color car? What kind of car? The clearer your goal, the greater your faith. Faith works on clarity. One sinner with a goal has more power than 10,000 Christians without a goal. Goals work for humans, not for believers. It works for humans. 9/11 terrorist attack. They had a goal. Had a goal. If you wrote down, I want to be married, add the word happily. Now, review them and choose 3 that create an energy in you. Not all goals have the same impact on you. Choose the 3 that excite you the most tonight and put A, B, and C besides those 3. The 3 that excite you the most. Just put A, B, and C. Now turn to the very front of the book, the cover, and on the inside is another blank space inside the front cover. Notice how it's blank. I'm going to ask you to write some words on the inside, the back cover. Write these words. We're going to talk about a world-class life. I call it the 10 life, living life at the 10. Put these words. Top 10 investors. Who are the top 10 investors in your life? Who's invested energy? King was pointing out people tonight who had invested in her life. They invested correction. They invested time. They invested money. You are the CEO, Chief Executive Officer of your life. You are a corporation. You're the CFO, the Chief Financial Officer. You're the CIO, the Chief Information Officer. Your life is a company. You identify the investors. Who invested in you? Inspiration, kindness, open the door to others. Who are the top 10 investors in your life? What has been the return on their investment in you? Their return, not yours. What's been their return?
Ladies, it's time to ignite your life and become a new woman.
On the King Binion Show.
Get the tools to help fight for your breakthrough, mind, body, and soul. Join author, speaker, life and business coach, King Binion, for the Ignite Your Life Women's Conference.
I pledge to totally equip, encourage, and empower you ladies.
Log on and register today at kingpinion.com. That's kingpinion.com.
Under that, put top 10 proteges. Top 10 proteges. Who can learn from you? You may have 5 children, but only one of them can really learn from you. You may have 3 brothers, but only one of them learns from you. What is wisdom? The ability to recognize differences. And so we're bringing distinction in your relationships. Not every relationship has the same value. Jesus had 7 kinds of relationships. 7 different relationships. And he had a vocabulary for every one of those 7. Remember that your success begins with recognition of difference. Difference in others, difference in you. Now right under that, 10 top mentors. Who are 10 people you're able to learn from at some level? You may never meet them, but through their books, through their tapes, then you'll have your own Elijah one day. Somebody that stays close to you, somebody you want to stay close to as they pour into you. Who are you willing to learn from? Whose counsel do you pursue? And what's the price you're willing to pay for their knowledge? Next, the top 10 questions. The most powerful thing you will do today is ask questions. It's more powerful than prayer. Because until you ask a question, you will not know how to pray. A question is proof of passion, proof of desire, evidence of trust. I know your intelligence when I hear you ask questions. I can discern your character when I hear the questions you ask. The most important thing I have done today is not speak here. The most important thing I have done today is ask questions. The most important thing I will do in the next 24 hours is ask questions. Unending self-talk. Questions like, if you were your enemy, how would you destroy you? If you had 12 months left to live, who would you train? Who are the top 5 people in your life that want your advice and not your money? When you begin to ask questions, you begin to purge your life, purify your life, until you can identify who's worthy of access, where you want to invest your world, invest your energy. Write down top 10 decisions. Where should you be making decisions right now? And you do their decisions. Where should I invest my time? Time is divine currency. If you cannot manage 24 hours, you'll never manage your life. If you cannot manage your mind, you'll never manage your world. Decisions. Where should I invest my energy, my time? Who qualifies for investment? The seed is not the only thing important in your life. The soil determines the future of your seed. It's not enough to sow. You must see where you sow. It's all the difference in the world. Write this down. Top 10 changes. What are the changes I want in my life? Where are they? One may be in your job, one may be in your family, one may be wherever it is. Where are top 10 changes? Lay your hand on that list. There's about 20 more, but lay your hand on that list right now and say, right now,
I prophesy to my life.
Wrong things you're leaving.
Wrong things wrong things are leaving.
Right things are happening.
And right things are happening.
I have the mind of Christ.
I have the mind of Christ.
And every decision I make.
And every decision I make.
Will bring joy and increase.
Will bring joy and increase.
Amen.
Amen.
I believe.
Amen.
I've written 320 books. My goal was 1,001. I've been asking the Lord how to make that happen. It's coming together. I will say, I have some books back in the back, and you can have any four for $20. Here's one, 31 Secrets of an Unforgettable Woman. And I studied the life of Ruth, found about 31 secrets in her life. There's five women in the Bible I fell in love with. Ruth was one of them. Phenomenal woman who understood timing with a man. Very rare woman. Esther understood that. And this is a very powerful book, and we have some copies there. We also have the Law of Recognition. Out of the 320 books I've written, this is the book. If I had just one to write, this would be the book I'd write. It's powerful. Next to the Bible, it's God's favorite book. I say this everywhere, and it never corrects me, so it must be okay. I wrote this in 17 hours on my knees, the Law of Recognition. My 18th millionaire. We've asked God to raise up 300. We have 31 so far. My 18th millionaire had 77 checks that bounced, lost his credibility, lost everything he had, and came to hear me speak at a school of wisdom. And no, that was my 31st millionaire. I'm sorry. My 18th millionaire was in Brazil also. But he read this book, changed his life, became a multimillionaire just through the principles of the keys in this book. So I hope you'll take advantage of it. Women have been a study for me for a long time. And I trusted my mother's love. I think my daddy wanted to love me. My brothers and sisters tried to love me. But my mother had the ability to love me. And more than that, it was believable love. Love you can't feel isn't love at all. I wouldn't give you a nickel for love I can't feel. My mother was very strict, very straightforward, very outspoken. I've seen her look at people in our dad's church, and she'd look at her mom and said, "Your hair's never looked that bad. I've never seen you look this bad before. What's wrong with your hair?" And that was my mother, just real direct. You just always knew what she was thinking. So when I started in my teenage years, I started... didn't date much at all. I went to Bible college. There were several concerns because I just never saw anybody that I was really drawn to like that. And then when I was 19, I saw a young lady, fell in love with her, just head over heels. Only girl I'd ever kissed, only girl I'd ever held hands with in my life, and just was crazy about her. Was married 13 years, then my world came apart. It was a very, very difficult time for me in the court. And because you don't quit loving because you go through pain. Those who can stop your love didn't ever have it. And you love, you love. You can't help it, but it hurts you not. You love. But through that time, I've been single now 33 years. I'm 66 years old. And since that time, I've studied very deeply because I didn't want to be deceived. We all have the pain of being deceived. And so I remember one time I fell in love with a girl from New York, a Puerto Rican girl, beautiful girl. And I said, "Mother, do you think she loves me?" My mother said, "Oh, there's no doubt, son, she loves you." And then she added, "Now, if she'll love you 6 months from now, I don't really know." And she was right, it didn't last 6 months. I really trusted my mother's decision. She loved learning. She was very straightforward. Just loved the things of God. Phenomenal teacher. Everybody wanted to be in her classes. Just a marvelous teacher. But there's seven qualities of a world-class woman. And when I say world-class, meaning anywhere on the earth, you're not beneath, but you're above. Deuteronomy 28. Seven qualities of a world-class woman. I know when I say Proverbs 31, you're going to think of the business woman, because that's where she majored. Business is just exchanging what you have for something you want. That's all business is. Exchanging what you have for something else you want. The Bible is a book about business. If I mention Ruth, we'll all remember that she's a great-grandmother of David, Solomon, who ushered in the lineage of Jesus. If I say Esther, an incredible queen who knew how to expose Haman, the assassin of the Jews. When I mentioned people like Abigail, 46 facts about Abigail's life, married to a very, very stupid rich man. She became David's confidant and wife. So I study these things very carefully because there is a difference. There's a difference in women. There's a difference in men. Now you don't hear that and go, that's a man for you. That's a man for you. That's a woman for you. And remember that book, Women Are From Venus and Men Are From Mars? Is that right? A lot of truth in that little book. Too much truth. But I felt stirred tonight to share with you these seven qualities that maybe you've already developed them, maybe it's something you want to develop. The gospel has two parts, the person of Jesus and his principles. The person of Jesus prepares me for heaven, but his principles prepare me for the earth. The person of Jesus creates my peace, but the laws of God create my prosperity. The person of Jesus prepares my heart to live right. But the laws of God prepare me for success. God loving me does not add a dollar to my name. Me loving God doesn't add a dollar to my name. But me applying the laws of God. Psalms 112, a man that loves the laws of God, wealth and riches will be in his house. Every time I have lack in my life, I know I broke a law. I know I broke a law. Maybe the law of focus. Maybe the law of discretion. Maybe the law of protocol. I've lost a lot in my life for not recognizing the law of protocol, which is expected behavior in an environment.
Well, it's time for you to ignite your life. Do you feel like you never have enough? Do you feel stuck emotionally, physically, mentally, and spiritually? Do you feel disappointed by your current life circumstances? Are you struggling in or with your relationships? Are you battling with your weight or health? Have you ever wondered what it would feel like to be, do, and have everything that you want in life? At the Ignite Women's Conference, you're gonna experience some dynamic teaching from world-class leaders who have mastered their professions. We're gonna equip you with some resources and tools necessary to help you grow and change from the inside out. I look forward to meeting you and your friends at the upcoming event. I wanna hear from you. Please leave a comment on my website. Again, it's kingpinion.com. Connect with me on Facebook and also follow me on Twitter. Cheers to your success.
Every time there's a loss in my life, I know I broke a law. I know that. These are seven qualities to me of a world-class woman. Been around a few thousand in my world. And always examining and seeing. Because I like what Aristotle Onassis said, the husband of Jackie Kennedy, the Greek tycoon billionaire. He said if it wasn't for women, men would not even have a real need for money. Which meant, of course, that it's man's purpose to create And the woman is the wealth manager of the earth, according to Rebecca in the book of Genesis. So we know that God made woman to be the wealth manager of the earth. We'll get into that in a few moments or tomorrow. But it's very important. The first quality of a world-class woman is she's a master conversationalist. A world-class woman is a master conversationalist. Sometimes a man needs entertainment, not education. A woman who knows how to talk to a man has mastered life. You've mastered life. If you can talk to a man whose broken focus is obvious, talking to a man, I'm saying this because no matter what we say, a man's in our world. Men are in our world. And we may gather ourselves in every way possible, but somewhere along the road in our life, there's going to be have the man that we converse with. It was the secret of the Queen of Sheba. Today in my room, I was thinking, how do you impress a Solomon? He built a temple worth $500 billion. Now, if you had $1 million in $1,000 bills, it'd be 12 inches high. But if you had $1 billion in $1,000 bills, it'd be higher than the Empire State Building. This man had it. She took 9 months to take a trip to meet him. Gave him a gift of $4 million. That was nothing to him, like spending money. Yet she fascinated Solomon through her words. I tell my sisters, I said, beauty gets a man's attention, but her words get his heart. Beauty gets a man's attention, but words secure his heart. Proverbs 7, Proverbs 31. A man is affected heavily, deeply, by a woman's tongue, by her words. I looked at a girl one night that I was on a date with, and I said, I'm not your six-year-old boy. I think you got me mixed up. A world-class woman is a world-class conversation. When to talk to a man. How to talk to a man. Every man has a king and a fool in him. And the one you address is the one that responds. Abigail was married to a very wealthy man named Nabal. David sent 10 men to get some food. The man cussed all of them out. David went crazy. The sweet psalmist of Israel went out of his mind. Threw his harp to the side, stomped on it, pulled out his sword and his spear, and said, I'm going to kill everything Nabal owned. There are times that in my life I am barely inside the kingdom. How many have times in your life that you're barely inside the kingdom, holding on to your life? I'm 7/8 Irish, 1/8 Cherokee Indian, and that is the same equation as a terrorist. I'm against terrorism, but it's really hard to be against the terrorists because I sort of feel like they do. Abigail's, the servants of Nabal, heard that he had cursed him out, pulled Abigail to the side, and shared with her what had happened. She grabs a mule, rushes down the trail, sets a mule in front of David. Men don't want a lot, but what they won't live without. And notice what she didn't say to David. What kind of man are you? He said you was love God, you worship God. Look how you act. Look at you. Look at you. Now the king and the fool was in him. But she talked to the king in him. Have you ever met in your life any man who thought he was wrong? Have you? It's a man. But she spoke to the king that was in him. And the king responded. And here's what she said to him. Everybody knows about the purity of your life. You have no scars on your diary. God's going to handle your enemies like a stone out of a slingshot. Now, why would she talk about a stone in a slingshot? Because that was his world. Do you remember Pamela Harriman, who married four or five billionaires? Every one of them. She didn't kill them, they just died naturally. But every one of them died. And then she worked 2 or 3 years, meet another one, and he married her. And the mystery of her life was written up in People magazine. And they asked her, how did you manage to always get married to such a successful achiever? Men who were renowned, men who were brilliant, men who were intellectual, men who had billions of dollars. And she said, I don't know except, and this is what she said, except I've always immersed myself in the world of the man I love. I entered his world. I immersed myself to understand. Because you don't understand a man by looking at him. You understand a man by looking at what he looks like. You study his face.